Happy New Year, everybody. And welcome to the first meeting of 2016. As we start off every meeting with general public comment, is there anyone here that would like to comment on anything? I'm looking at you as the only general public.
I don't really have a comment. I'm here because I'm the head of an organization that will be submitting a request. So I just am bringing myself up to speed, basically.
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you for coming. We have three new members. Hoorah! So what, we're turning over, we lost two, we're gaining three. So this is very exciting. It might be nice for us to go around and introduce ourselves. And perhaps say what brought you here and who you represent. So, can we do that? That's all right, anyone want to start? I could start and then we'll just go around. How's that? So my name is Brian Adams. And this is my second, second round as chair of the committee. And I am appointed by the city council. And I hope I've been reappointed. Sarah, do you have any idea about that?
The council hasn't met. They're still sort of organizing.
Okay. So I did talk to Bill Dwight. My term expires now, so.
You serve until you are replaced, so
Oh. That's
okay.
Okay, so I'll just keep on serving.
So I'm a city council appointee.
Julia Shevin, I am the representative for Parks and Recreation Commission.
Yay.
I'm Sarah LaValle, and I staff the committee, and I'm coming to my sixth year.
Wow. And for all new people, Sarah is really the go-to woman. We defer to her on all things important. She guides us through as the paid staff person in a remarkably efficient and wonderful way. Although sometimes the technology has been challenging, but we're hoping that resolves itself.
I'm impressed with this.
I am too. It looks really pretty cool.
I'm Jack Finn, and I'm representing the Conservation Commission.
I'm Chris Hellman, and I'm one of the elected participants.
Yay.
And I'm Linda Morley, and I'm a mayoral appointee, ostensibly because I have knowledge of how to the area passing.
I'm David Whitehill, and I'm another at-large elected member.
We have a requirement for several Davids to be on the staff. right where we're sitting. My name is David Drake. I'm chairman of the Historical Commission, and through that appointed to this committee, and the longest serving member of this committee. I go back to the time when carts rumbled through the village and so
forth. Right. 1800s.
Yes.
Well, welcome new members. We'll do our best to explain what the process is, but if you'd like to stay after or meet early one evening or somewhere else, I can help you go through what the process is. Please stop us at any time if you're confused as to what's going on. Not to say we aren't confused as to what's going on, but we'll help guide you through that. We have two sets of minutes to approve, November 4th and November 18th.
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor of both those? Are we? Yes. All those opposed? Okay. Chair's report. I have little to report except for the fact that Sarah, help me if I'm misinterpreting this. But the city received a land grant for the Rocky Hill acquisition.
Yeah, we did.
And we had appropriated on our last round $90,000, but it will go down now to $55,000. Is that correct, Sarah?
That is correct. It's unfortunately not for this year, it's for next year, so we won't be able to do our closing until a year from now. But our option allows us to have that flexibility.
Okay.
Can you explain that?
So, in the proposal,
yeah.
They'd asked for $90,000. The city had asked for $90,000. But if the land grant came in, it would be reduced to 55,000. So we're up now 35,000, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah. In addition, $35,000 more to spend on this round or to do as we see. So for the three new folks, we appropriated 90,000 for a land acquisition effort on Rocky Hill, it's called, which is on Route 10 going across from the Audubon Sanctuary. And Wayne Fiden, our city planner, is very adept at getting grants from the state and other places. So he was able to finagle, he, along with Sarah and others, yet another grant to help the city in the open space acquisition. So we had appropriated $90,000. Now with the land grant, we only have to pay $55,000. The rest comes to us from the state. So hooray for Sarah and Wayne and whoever else was active in that. Other than that, I got nothing. Moving right along, next on the agenda. So we have two extensions, correct? Grow Food and the Northampton Historic Commission.
Yes, so these were both already voted on at the last meeting, but this is just formally approving the language that will allow these to be extended by a year. So I just took the exact same contract and MOU from the previous awards and changed the dates and the amounts.
Great, so is there anything that we need to discuss on these? Yes.
Just to refresh.
Sure.
Linda?
I just for clarity's sake, I wondered if rather than doing a whole new contract so that it looks like there's two contracts for the same amount of money for different time periods, whether you could just do a little extension document that says simply that you're amending the previous contract to extend the term for another year?
We can't, unfortunately. We have to go through the full new contract process and get a new contract number, or else we won't be able to pay any invoices. But I agree that that would be much easier.
Okay.
Yeah, once it's expired, then it's gone. We have to have a new one at that point.
Well, then I wonder if you could just insert something into the whereas language, just so that somebody looking at it could follow it, and something about whereas it previously awarded these funds and the request an extension and grant them the extension for a year or another, you know, so that they're entering into a second contract for the same amount.
So, again, for
you're
the...
looking like you think you did that. Did I miss that?
No, I'm just thinking where we could put it. But that does make sense. So
would it go under terms, which is saying that the deadline for completion is a year? Would that... It's really not a term, is it? Well, Sarah's thinking, for new people, we were... when we authorize payment for projects, and for whatever reason, in the 3 years that we allow grantees to complete the work, if for whatever reason they can't do it, they can come and request an extension. And in this case, two projects came forward, Grove Food in Northampton and the State Hospital project, which is a fountain historic commemoration thing, both asking for a year extension. So that's what we're quickly dealing with.
All right, so we can actually see that.
Huh?
This works, okay.
Ooh, cool.
So maybe put it in this clause that says what the grantee shall do. So the grantees shall create community garden for the former Alley Farm, and then just add a little clarification somewhat in there and extended by the Community Preservation Committee, because the council resolution is still active.
Yeah, okay.
And that would go under both contracts, is that correct?
Yeah. So subject to the project application and extension request.
Linda, that's good. That language is appropriate.
Yeah, I think that. Yeah.
And then I just put in the contract number there. So just to say that this contract is an extension of a previous award.
Great. And you will do that for both of them.
And just one other quick thing, if I might, Brian. I noticed on the face page, Sarah, of the grantee contract cover sheet, you've got the period of contract coverage as 3 years. I think it just missed it changing that. Number five, on the grow food grantee contract cover sheet.
Okay, awesome.
Anything else?
Well, so are we satisfied with the language on the fountain? It was controversy about whether they could do the planning without purchasing the land or purchasing the land.
Yeah, so at the last meeting, the committee agreed not to change that clause, so that's still in. That the funds have to be expended on the fountain first. They can't be spent on the park.
Okay, I didn't know if there was a change.
To bring people off to speed, would you mind if I did that for a moment? Your Honor?
Yes.
Okay. When Mass Development spearheaded the development of what was Hospital Hill, he took over the master plan and essentially control the use of the land there for good reason. There was a promise made that the land would be set aside to commemorate the state hospital and all that it meant, for good or bad, to the people of Northampton. The city had saved, set aside a large cast iron fountain that once ran on the front lawn of the hospital. And it was found that after all of the land excavation and movement and so forth, the base of that fountain still existed, had survived, and was on a piece of a small parcel of land, a quarter acre, I think, that was pocket park size. And so the plan now is to replace the fountain back onto its original foundation. And there are a group of citizens that are working on raising money to restore the cast iron, and then hopefully at some point in the future to be able to make it work as an actual fountain. That process is more complex than it would be if it were simply getting approval from the city council, because of all of the concerns and details that Mass Development has to go through. So it has turned into a long process. But it is still, the pieces of it, like the pieces of the fountain, the pieces are all still there, and it's going to come together. So it will just take a little bit more time, and so the people who are working on the fountain came before us and said, can we have a little bit more time, another year, to make this happen? And the committee voted to allow that. But I'd be happy to answer any questions. I'm not on that subcommittee working on the fountain, but I know a little bit about it, and be happy to answer any questions on it. It's a great idea.
Uh-huh. I actually have a question either for Sarah or David. There was talk at the presentation about the chicken and egg problem. Mass Development,
yes,
wanted all the money to be raised before they would transfer the money, and they felt that they needed to, that if they had the site, that the fundraising would be easier, and there was some talk about meeting with the mayor.
Right, because of the holidays, I didn't get to that. And I should, and I will try to do that before our next meeting. Basically, the concept is that it was, I sat on the original Hospital Advisory Committee back when Mayor Higgins would put in this, working on that development, putting this together, and there was a clear commitment on Mass Development's part to have a park we set aside a memorial of the hospital. Memories fade over time, and so the Mass Development is not sure of what their commitment is, but they're that way right now. And I'm quite sure of what was said during that time. So I made a commitment to this committee to go and talk with the mayor and see if we can get the mayor's intercession to help do this. I don't think it'll be hard, frankly. I mean, it's not a buildable lot, and it's got the foundation of the fountain right there. And you could not get a more perfect kind of a scenario. We have a fountain, we have a fountain base, we have, you know, it's a good spot for it. And I don't foresee any real difficulty. I think it's just bureaucratic inertia to get over at this point. But Mass Development had asked, we don't want to turn this over to you unless you can deliver us a finished package almost immediately, or, you know, unless you raise all the money for this project. We don't want to have a half-built eyesore. And the people working on the project from the historical end were saying, well, you know, we're getting pushback from potential donors because we don't have the commitment on the property yet. And so it is a chicken-egg phenomenon, because they need to get a commitment from Mass Development that the property is going to be seconded back to the city, returned to the city. And so we just need to break that little bureaucratic logjam.
And David, what is the message to the mayor? What is the message to the mayor?
The mayor would be a request to the mayor to ask for his intercession to work with Mass Development to facilitate the handing over, or the commitment of that quarter acre plot to the city for park usage.
Without
the requirement of all the money for the development of the park being held in advance. In part because, I mean, the logic there being that the city could easily say, well, our vision of the park is just a mow of grass with a large concrete circle in the middle of it, and so we have the money for that now. So give us the park. In other words, the only reason that park has money, has sizable money attached to its planning, is because of the largeness of the vision, and there's a restoration of the fountain. If the city simply wanted to have a little triangle park, that would cost almost nothing. And so, you know, for Mass Development to ask for a large amount of deposit doesn't, you know, it seems like that's a fluid amount, and so it doesn't seem like a reasonable request. Furthermore, the commitment was there to make this park to begin with, and so it seems like I don't think it's in anybody's interest to just sit on it. I don't think Mass Development is doing that. I give them far more credit than that. I think it's just a bureaucratic thing that needs to be dealt with.
Great.
Just wanting to protect the CPA money that has been set aside for that, so that if something isn't started and then doesn't come to fruition.
Well, the group involved certainly would not, and have not, embarked on the expenditures if the money was not going to be available. And I think the council, which has to approve of our expenditure, would make that clear as well. So I think there seem to be appropriate safeguards.
Great. Any other discussion on these two extensions? Is there a motion to approve? Do we need that for this, or will we just?
We do. We can do both together.
And then we need to sign as well, Sarah, is that right?
We do not need to sign. With the charter change, we need to go on to sign the contract. And these appointees have to be signed by the applicants first.
So motion to approve both the State Hospital Foundation and the Grow Food Extensions?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor? All opposed? All right, thank you, Sarah. And thank you, David, for meeting with the mayor sooner rather than later, right?
Thank you.
So we, reviewing round one for 2016, we're looking at the schedule.
So the only two dates in this that are absolutely concrete, because I've already told applicants, are eligibility sheets being due and application being due. And then I used the previous round schedule to put together the rest of it. Eligibility sheets are due early next week. Q&A for applicants, if there are any, we haven't had any in recent rounds, would be at our regular CPC meeting January 20th, which will also be the day that we need to have the public hearing on the present on the CPA plan, followed by another business meeting on the 3rd, which we may choose not to have. There's no business for that one. Applications due February 8th. Packets being sent out on the 10th. With the CPA members' questions being sent back to me on the 18th. And then we've generally not had a meeting during President's Week, but if we wanted to move things up. Site visits are to be determined based on availability and the types of applications that we get in. And then I send the questions out the next day after I get them. Applicants respond to me on the 25th. And then these are really a guess based on the number of applications that we receive, because it's hard to know how many meetings with applicants to schedule without knowing how many applications we have.
Can you go back, Sarah? There's no February meeting, am I missing that? Oh, no, there is a...
February 3rd, and then skip the second meeting. Unless people want to meet the week of President's Week this time as well.
I think we're not meeting because Downey was always off gallivanting around his kids, right? Can we schedule a meeting during that? Does that conflict for those folks? Yes, it does.
How are we going?
I'm
okay.
I'm going as well.
Well, let's not do that then. So what was that, the 17th, Sarah? No. Yeah.
Yeah, it's the week that starts the 15th.
So that would be been the 17th, right?
Yeah.
Can we go with the following one, the 24th? Is that right? That will work. And Sarah will send all this out to those of us calendar lists.
So meet the 24th. The only issue with that is questions won't be back from applicants. So if we start meeting with the applicants then, we won't have those questions in hand unless we ship some other thing around.
So waiting to the March the 2nd?
Yeah, so that way when we meet with applicants, we'll have all the written responses from them in hand.
Well, that makes sense. So March 2nd, March 16th, April 6th, April 20th. So that's our crunch, those four. Two in March, and two in April, and maybe one in May as well. Can we leave it like this, or do we need to finalize those?
And this is fine for now. It's hard to schedule it without knowing how many applications we're going to get. Uh-huh. And I don't have a good sense of that yet.
Have you gotten any?
We have 5 eligibility forms so far.
Okay. And eligibility forms are due when again?
Due Monday. I believe that's Monday.
Next Monday.
This kind of, yeah. This
Monday the 11th. And you have 5 in so far. Okay. So we'll leave it at this point, and then the next meeting we'll reconvene knowing how many applicants and how to schedule our March and April meetings, correct? Yes. So for new folks, this last round we had 9 applicants, wasn't it? Which is a lot for us. And given our intent to give them their fair share. It was difficult even to get it done in two long meetings. So that's why we're waiting on this to see. Five is much more manageable. Well, we've had five before, right?
Five, I think, is the most we've had.
Five was the most until this last round?
No, in one meeting.
Oh, right.
So we've done five applicant meetings in one meeting, but yeah. I don't think we've done beyond that.
So, and are new people, do new people get the difference between the eligibility sheets and the applications? Is that clear to the three of you? Yes?
I've seen that packet from the phone,
okay.
So I've gone through it.
Yeah. So eligibility sheets are just, yeah. Yes, go ahead and apply, making sure. And Sarah is the one that really determines that, although I'm supposed to take a look at it as well, right, Sarah?
Yeah. I will let you know.
Great, thank you. All right, anything else on that? Good to go? Okay, so we were all to look at our sections of the current plan and make recommendations for an update of the community preservation plan. And hopefully folks had an opportunity to do that. Sarah, did you get feedback from some of us?
I did, yeah.
Okay.
So the last version that I sent out included everybody's changes to date.
Okay, good. Our intent in this meeting is not to wordsmith, to not look at style, God forbid, but to look at substance. If there's any glaring things from, if people had a chance to look at the revised draft, and things stand out that we need to discuss, we will have an opportunity for the public to weigh in 2 weeks from tonight.
2 weeks from tonight. So that is, we typically do that and the public hearing to receive public input about the needs related to community preservation, which is required in the enabling legislation.
And
we don't have to do it related to a plan, but that's the way we've always done it.
And that allows us to revise even further the plan, yeah, if we see the need to do that. So tonight, it's simply looking at if we have big issues or even small issues that, again, are not stylistic or wordsmithing, that can be, that there's still opportunity to get that to you, Sarah, correct? Yeah.
Unless it's sort of major. I know the recreation section, everyone agreed, read sort of strangely, like a press pamphlet. So.
Yeah, and I brought it to the Rec Commission on Monday. I brought this actually to the Parks and Rec, and it reads like the original intent of what was supposed to happen with the CPC for Parks and Rec, and now that's all happened. I mean, it's a lot of history as opposed to what are the current needs that Rec has. And the conversation at Parks and Rec is that the current needs really revolve around rehabilitation and renovation of the fields and the spaces that we have. So a great example would be, is everybody familiar with Elbrook Fields? The Elbrook Fields? So the Elbrook Field space was a space that was new, it was built, a couple of fields were put in there, and there's this huge area that's unused. It's not been developed, it's not been in any way used by city residents. I think maybe the high school ultimate team was there for a year. It's not a real field. So that would be an example of the kind of thing that we're looking at now from Parks and Rec is, can we do better with the spaces we have? We may have some land acquisition possibilities as well. So that, and that doesn't read in this at all from Parks and Rec. It's really, as you said, a brochure and a history.
So were there suggestions to change the reading at?
Yeah, it was really in the section on needs, it's to revise that section substantially to talk more about, and I have a list of the fields that are priority fields for rehabilitation and renovation.
And has that gone into Sarah? That goes?
That happens. Because Julia got it.
I got this, and then I was there.
Appointed.
Okay.
So I will get that on.
Great. Good. So that's the rec section. Historic? David?
He looks good. Sarah did an excellent job capturing and reminding readers of all of the wonderful projects that the CPA has supported in recent years, and really refreshed it and updated it so that some of the larger and more renowned projects are listed, including the Port Library and the Academy, First Church, City Hall, et cetera, et cetera. But I think that makes it more alive to anyone reading this. It's great.
Linda, housing?
I'm still on, if I can, on historical.
Yeah.
There was some real discussion around the Union Street Jail and the whole notion of a privately owned structure and what the parameters were around being able to use public tax dollar CPA funds for a privately owned structure. And so it might be useful to give a little bit more guidance in the plan itself around that whole notion, because it can be, but there has to be a public benefit that flows from it. So I could think a couple of sentences around the issue. So establishing you can give you CPA funds for privately owned structures, but only if the funds are used to further a public benefit, and some examples of that being either a preservation restriction or a grant of public access where there previously was not a grant of public access, to give some notion. Because I think that was the most contested issue around that whole application. So I think it would be useful to, as an addition.
Nowhere does the present plan address that issue of...
It does not.
Public.
So it does talk about...
it doesn't sort of...
One of the
evaluation criteria, but not as eligibility. And it would be useful, I think, in the eligibility section.
Or even...
I don't mean... even beyond that, Sarah, the listing, the guidance, that's where it is.
So once again, for new folks, we had a project, and this was a year ago, two rounds ago?
Yeah.
Where the old jail, which is now condos, the Association of Condo Owners came looking for CPC money to fund the stairs?
There's large external stairways and granite stairways.
Which are not available for the public. I mean, it's a private... a condo association. So we voted against it because of that reason. There seemed to be no public access or public good to a private project, even though it was clearly historic preservation. It was not something that was available to anyone other than the condo owners. So that's what we're trying to...
Mike, your comment is entirely helpful, and I think it was a great discussion, and I voted with the committee. The only reaction I have is this is intended to be sort of a general plan. Mm-hmm. We also have regulations that specifically make it much more difficult to seek funding for entirely private expenditure as this one was. So I just don't know whether we want to put all of our regulatory language into the plan, which to me is more... more general in its intent, or whether, which is fine if we do, or whether we'd want to have some of that more restrictive, specific regulatory language simply reside in the regulations that we operate with.
I don't. I don't. Is it in the?
I thought it just came from
the anti-aid amendment to the Massachusetts Constitution.
It's completely allowable to spend CPA funds on a private building, whether or not there's public access, but maybe, at least in the evaluation criteria, we could add.
The committee will
be thinking about this.
I think only if there's public good. So it doesn't need to be public access, but there needs to be some public benefit, because you can't use the public dollars for a purely private benefit. So
theoretically, the benefit could be someone walking by and seeing what a nice set of stairs, and it's up to this committee to decide that.
They could, right. if there was some assurance of that, and that's why you need the preservation restriction. Because the preservation restriction...
It seems tricky to put that where it's really going to be a case-by-case basis to decide that. To put it as a guideline on a plan seems...
I think you can put the concept that you can use it for privately owned structures if there's a public benefit.
Like First Churches. I mean, that was a unanimous decision among the committee, that the public good there was overwhelming.
And there's public access.
It's on Main Street.
And they gave a preservation restriction so that they assured that
So is there a sentence there that, Sarah, you're suggesting that under this project evaluation criteria?
I think it should go in earlier under eligibility, because it really is an eligibility issue.
It's a prerequisite.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's misleading to put it in an evaluation criteria.
Yeah, it just gets a little, it gets interesting because according to the, if the committee wanted to say, we'll only consider it eligible if, and go above and beyond the enabling legislation, you certainly could do that, but this project eligibility parrots the enabling legislation, which doesn't address public access.
Right, but that's because it's talking about what the community preservation statute says, but there's a separate constitution which says, which we also have to consider.
I mean, it's an interesting issue because I mean there are a host of situations that arise in the area of low and moderate income housing where the funds that we've expended could be argued redound to the benefit of individuals to the private benefit, whether it's the credit counseling, the support for the, in a sense, the capital expended that results in supporting low and moderate income housing. So there are always going to be projects that have a judgment call to them. I certainly do not support the expenditure of Northampton tax dollars for private historical restoration projects, and I would have to be really, you know, strongly convinced otherwise. And everything we supported had been clearly public and clearly publicly accessible. But I think at the same time, some of this is contract language. My only concern is not the intent of what you're saying, and I think your quotation of the Mass. Constitution is absolutely accurate. I don't have any problem with it at all. I'm a big supporter of that. It's just a question of, to me, where we place this language, because this is, to me, a master plan document and not a regulatory document. That's my say on that, and I'll leave it up to the committee.
I agree that, you know, the fine points and the judgments don't belong in the plan. It's just the general overview of the statement to create some kind of foundation of understanding of what the limits are, and that's it. So not going into great length, a sentence or two is really what I'm suggesting to sort of put the points in the...
Okay.
Chris?
My question was this idea of public funds for private entities, is it unique to the historic component of the work here, or is it something that you can envision being applied to any of the other areas where we do granting? And if the answer to that is yes, then maybe the place to position it is not here, but in the more general portion of the document, the introductory portion, where there will be a discussion of this idea of These funds are not limited to purely public entities. They can be used for private, however, and then some statement about a higher level of, and I want to try and accommodate what you were saying, which is because it sounds like there's some statutory language when it comes to the historic part, but not limited to just statutory language, just this idea that we're willing to entertain the use of public funds on private entities, but we're going to hold it to a maybe a higher standard of review.
You can, sir, we have specific guidelines that we hand out to applicants, correct?
It's the plan, basically.
And we have done in the past. I mean, I know if somebody had comes in with a project, we carefully crafted here in the past guidelines that we've handed out to so that people are not chasing a red herring.
Well, it's the plan. So it's either the whole plan, or I know not everybody reads the whole plan, at least the administration piece of it that tells you what you can do and how to do it.
But if there's something in the Constitution that broadly limits the distribution of funds, it should be in there. I mean, that's a pretty big criteria that needs to be followed, and it should be in there.
Yeah.
Whether it's on this page or that page, it should be clear to people that it needs to be a public good. And I agree, two sentences saying it can be privately. In a sense, affordable housing is the exception, where there's a broad agreement that this private good is
becomes a
public good. Yeah, and that's sort of the thing.
And I think where the issue is cloudiest, yes, I think there's sort of agreement as to that, and where the issue seems to arise is in the arena of historic preservation. So,
okay.
I mean, what you're saying logically makes sense, but as a practical matter,
right.
I think we're
because there's been no applications for private swimming pools yet.
Right.
And it could come up with affordable housing, but it never has, because it's the provision of affordable housing has always been recognized as such an overarching public need that everyone's always seen it as fine to distribute it.
But we did approve something that was somewhat borderline on in recent memory. We approved the grant for the was it over on Bridge Road, what's the name of that housing, the project there where we worked on supported certain plant eradication
Lathrop.
On that trail.
Lathrop
community. Lathrop community is a nonprofit, independent but non-governmental organization.
But we determined their trails were open to the public.
But we determined that they'd make the trail open to everybody, and that it was a lot of financial contributions already in hand, and had a public good because the plants don't know property boundaries, and so it had a lot of things going for it. But it was, you know, we looked through it very carefully, and it was, even though in a sense private, non-profit, we still funded it. So there are some situations that where we can do that because there is a broader public good, and I'm happy to support those. Again, I just think that this is, because we have a lot of new members here, so this is something, this plan comes out every few years, right?
It used to be every 1 year, and then as the CPC got more developed, it went to every two, and that's now it's
no
set time.
Just periodically.
Say if Look Park came and asked for money to turn the paddle pool into a swimming pool.
Well, they have asked for help with that wall in the beginning, yeah.
But something specifically that, which is clearly a private entity, I mean, it's a private park, you have to pay to get in.
Which came up.
So where in the plan does it say that wouldn't be possible, that you shouldn't even ask? Or is it an evaluation? I don't know.
Well,
I mean, it's allowable, but the level of public access always comes up. So maybe it would be worth putting in. So these are the general criteria that apply to all projects, and we don't really spell out public access. And it sort of, it skirts around it a little bit, but not directly addresses it.
Even just language saying that there will be an evaluation of the degree of public access would be enough for people to think about
that. That certainly will, yeah.
I'm not sure it's quite correct to boil it down to public access, so that's what it often comes down to. It's a broader concept of public benefit.
Public.
Do we want to craft those sentences now, or do we want to ask Linda, this is your idea, with coming up with a couple sentences for the next meeting?
Sure.
Is that all right?
Sure.
It's hard to word crap as a group. So if you could have that for us, that would be great. And we're agreeing it comes, Chris, thank you for your suggestion, coming before the general eligibility stuff rather than specifically under historic preservation.
Actually, with those other examples, mm-hmm. that makes sense.
I think that makes sense, yeah. Great, thank you, Linda. Anything else on historic preservation? So recreation changes are coming, historic preservation. Linda, housing?
There was one issue I wanted to talk about because it needs discussion by the committee. And I'm sorry Tony's not here, because she probably has some thoughts on it too. If you've looked at the changes that Sarah made, there's a lot of the stuff on the preservation guarantees in general that's being amended or deleted. And then when you get into affordable housing, it is looking in the evaluation criteria for a 99-year restriction for multifamily rental housing and a third minimum 30-year restriction for homeownership housing. And I would like to look at that, the 99-year restriction on the multifamily housing, and consider that that not be an absolute, and that perhaps what it ought to do is track if there are state funds, state affordable housing funds in the project, that the city restriction track what the state's restriction is. Some of the time it will be 30 years, some of the time it will be 50 years, some of the time it will be 99 years. Because the bulk of the money is going to be coming from some other source, and to have the city drive the length of the preservation restriction seems inappropriate to me. And depending on, I know there is a lot of concern about preserving affordability, but each project is in a different site, in a different community, and the community has different needs. And you can end up locking a particular community into being low income in perpetuity if you have a lot of affordable housing projects with 99-year restrictions, and you end up dampening an ability to have developed economic development and other benefits in those communities. It also locks housing projects into caps on their income, on the rents that they can afford, which is important for preserving affordability on the one hand, but on the other hand means that there's a limit on the amount of money that they have available to meet the capital needs. And 99 years in the life of a multifamily structure is a long time. There are limited federal and state and local funds for rehabilitation. You can't borrow from a bank if you can't pay it back, and if your rents are restricted. So there are incentives for projects to re-up their affordability and get more capital funds in, but to have an absolute 99-year requirement, I think, can be locking projects into some difficulties.
And where did we come up with this 99 years?
I don't know the origin of it, actually. It may have been what the state was using as a standard at that time. I'm not really sure.
And the state is not using that language now?
They don't require the 99 years. They, with their funds are very competitive, and you get more points in the competition if you're providing greater affordability. But 99 years is not required.
Yes, 30
if you're
years
using 30 years for, if you're doing a tax credit project, which is the way the bulk of the multifamily rental housing is done, it'll be a 30-year restriction. Some of the funding sources will ask for a 40-year or sometimes a 50-year, depends on. So you can make, it's a little crazy making, because when you put together an affordable housing project, you'll have one source of funds that's saying this period of affordability, or another that says this, you have another that says this. So I'm just looking for us not to exceed what the maximum period of affordability is.
Because we're good.
Well, theoretically, the money is going to be used for certain upgrades for a building, and it seems illogical that the restrictions without the physical upgrades that are happening with the money by 15 years, possibly.
Do you have suggestions for the language?
No, but I'd be happy to come up with it.
But the restrictions should match the tax benefit packages or protocols that the.
Well, there's usually a master affordable housing restriction, and how do you usually dovetail? Do you dovetail with the states?
If there's a master restriction, then yeah. The city is named in that as well.
But so you would use that, but would you? Are you requiring have you been requiring the 99 years in all cases, even if the master does not?
Not in all cases. I think every case we've had where there was a master, it happened to be 99 years, yeah. But that doesn't mean it's going to keep being that way.
Okay. So I can suggest.
So Linda, if I was a low-income housing advocate, if I look at you reducing that, it seems like we are lessening the protection for low-income people. If we're going down from 99 years, would we not be criticized for reducing the affordability, the long-term affordability?
The flip of that is, are we de-incentivizing the creation of low and moderate-income housing but requiring such a lengthy commitment? Because it's far in excess of the tax benefit package that the federal government will offer for certain kinds for creating low-income housing. So if you're going to get, if you can create low-income housing and get tax credits for 45 years of keeping it that way, but then you know that because you've got some CPC money, you have to keep it going for another 50 years, you're not going to be as inclined to create. That's a tax burden on the builder at that point. So somebody smarter in this field than me is going to have to give us advice, but I don't know if somebody can do that. Peg or somebody in planning can give us advice on this.
Or Linda.
Yeah. But. I'm sorry, yeah, of course, we don't want to distance, I'm supporting your point, and I don't want to disincentivize the creation of moderate and low-income housing by having such a lengthy requirement.
There's a tension there, and that's why it's not an easy issue. Obviously, going for 99 years, you're saying it's going to be low-income housing for 99 years. On the flip side, as I said, people are living in a community, and you can lock a community into being a low-income community, so the desirability of that housing it can be limited. And you also have to be realistic about, there are so many constraints that are put on affordable housing to maintain its affordability that the ability to actually maintain the housing appropriately, keep it in good condition, and be able to offer suitable, decent, safe, sanitary housing can be compromised because you don't have the ability to reinvest. If the state suddenly had lots and lots of money to make available for affordable housing, and you knew you could go back in 30 years to do your heating systems, your roof, your whatever, that would be one thing, but it doesn't at the moment. The federal government has moved away from a lot of its investment in affordable housing, so you're kind of asking the impossible, in a sense.
There's no industry standard?
Or Well, you know,
if somebody wants to get tax incentives to build affordable housing, is there a length of time that they have to keep it that way to get those tax benefits?
What they do for the tax credit, the federal income housing tax credit, has to be 30 years.
30 years, okay.
Some of the state programs are 30 years, some of them are 40, some of them are 50,
right.
Depends. But we have yet to see how all of this is going to play out, because what happens when, so you do get projects after 20 years looking to recapitalize, going back to that same well, looking for more affordable housing resources, because you can't go to a private bank and borrow money that you have to service, because you just don't have the income to meet your operating expenses plus any kind of significant debt service. So you can't go to a farm savings bank and borrow a couple $1 million to renovate it. So then you're going, so either you scrimp on the renovations, you go back to the state and hope for more, that you can get more money. Of course, you're competing with people trying to build new housing, and you know, it's scarce resources. So it's you know, 30 years or 40 years or 50 years is a long time. It would be great if you could ensure affordability in perpetuity, but you also have to find a way to ensure the suitability of the housing in perpetuity if you want to do that. And I think we really have a system to do that.
It's also important to think of the role of CPA money, just the size of the number of dollars given out compared to the number of dollars that are coming through the state systems. And you can't just take CPA money and build a project. It's more it seems to me it's more about the towns, you know, the city saying we are behind this project.
Yeah.
And when it comes down to it, if you look at the amount of money coming through CPA, and even 5 years at market rate, a developer would always go, not take the CPA money, just take 5 more years at market rate.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I mean, if you look at the percentage of the project that our contribution played in 129 Pleasant or in the lumberyard, I mean, we were at most doing, I don't know, just a few percentage points, I mean, single-digit percentage points on those projects.
Right. So,
and yet, it was enough to show our commitment. It was enough to get the project rolling if they wanted to see community commitment. So it was nice to be able to do it, but for us to put in a 99-year requirement on a, when we have a 7% stake, and I think I'm flattering myself, on those projects is ridiculous, because those mortgages are probably at most 30 years.
Well, as that gap starts to widen in terms of the restriction, we'll see people just not go for the CPA money.
Yeah, so I would favor reducing it to, what would you suggest, 30 years, 40 years?
She will come up with the language.
Can we tie it to a state island? Rather than having to.
Well, that depends on the source of funding, which state.
You're going to come back
sources.
With that?
So I'm thinking to leave it to be determined. I would make it probably at least 30 years. And generally consistent if there's a state affordability restriction, generally consistent with that, something vague like that. But I'll look.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
And Sarah, if in your travels you figure out where we came up with 99 years.
I'm guessing it was just repeating back what the state used for a guideline at that time, because the larger projects are still, or have still been required to use 99 years, so we haven't had any pushback about this. But if the state starts to reduce that, then it definitely makes sense to have something more restrictive for such a small percentage of funds.
So Linda, you'll come back with language for the next meeting.
Yeah.
Do you have other issues on housing that you?
I don't.
Can I ask a technical question? How can you guarantee housing ownership affordability? If you put restrictions on the sale price restrictions?
Yes.
Okay.
So anything else on housing? We'll revisit that as well. Jack, conservation or open space?
Open space looks pretty comprehensive. I mean, I'm still new at this, but I it just seemed pretty comprehensive about all the needs that we're looking at for priorities. So I couldn't come up with any, in my readings of it, anything to add to a pretty complete working document.
And I reviewed it as well and felt the same. I did some wordsmithing than I did with you, Sarah.
And I do have updated percentages of types of open space, and I'll put those in the report.
Great.
Brian, can I just ask a procedural question, Sarah?
Mm-hmm.
If you want to present the plan for public comment at the next meeting, do we need to have a finalized version out and available? And so do I need to get suggested language to you earlier?
We do. So I was thinking that the changes to recreation and the changes to housing and anything else could be included in the version that goes out for public comment, but it hasn't been approved by the committee yet, so that still can be done after the public hearing, but maybe by the end of this week, if that's possible, or early next
Julie,
week.
Julie, is that possible for you? Is that probable for you?
Monday, maybe?
Monday's a good weekend.
Highly probable.
Monday.
Did you need the odds?
No, I think highly probable is good.
Do we have that no wetlands acquired under CBA funding be yet ever eligible for use by the Bundy family? just a special little codicil there.
Birders, yes. Bundys, no.
Mm-hmm. A lot of strange things going on out in the world. Let's see, the new folks, did you have a chance to look at the whole document? Any more comments, further stuff? Yes, no, any comments that additional people have? Okay, so it would be nice if Sarah could give us back a revised copy of the plan before our meeting in 2 weeks, right, Sarah?
Yes.
And if there's a way to, on the changes, to highlight Linda's two suggestions.
Yeah, so none of these track changes will appear anymore, so great. These are, unless anyone has any comments about any of them.
No, I think that's great.
These will all be accepted.
So the only changes noted will be Linda's two things, and then a lot from Julia, or whatever from Julia, on the rec department stuff.
I apologize for that. I just had one last thing. Were you going to change this to reflect that this was done under Brian's tenure and not Downey's?
I was going to add, because there was so much overlap, I was just going to include everyone that was involved. But, let's see,
he wasn't really involved in discussions, or did he give any comments?
Yeah, and we've been doing it for a while.
Okay.
So... Yeah, so I all updated to reflect that Downey and Brian were both the chair during the update, and also Ed, the new member.
Any other stuff on the plan? So for new folks, we've done this a few times, and our track record is consistent. No one shows up to comment on the preservation plan. We get a lot of people showing up for other things, but not for that. So we'll hope that people do come, and WHMP, I'm sure, will publicize this incredibly and dedicate all programming for the next 2 weeks advertising. But other than that, it may be that we're just having a conversation among ourselves again, looking at the or approving it. And then we need so once we get the public comment, we would wait, and we would then incorporate that into the document before we voted on it again, is that right?
Yes.
Great. And do we want to discuss now how many years we want this to go? Because we can do whatever we want with that.
We can. So what I was thinking was just not saying how long it's good for, just having the date, which actually let me change that. 2016. But we could specify a certain number of years. A lot of the long-term plans that we reference will be up in 2017 and 2018.
So that's a question. Do we want to set a timetable for ourselves to update the plan or leave it open?
I like Sarah's idea. Just along that line, Sarah, I would take, I mean, not to wordsmith it, but I would take 2016 off that prominent spot on the top and just put it, you know, last revision, you know, 2016, something like that, down on the bottom, because this is not, if I put in 16, it implies that it's an annual document. And in fact, if I recall, there is no regulation requiring a certain interval between them.
That is correct, right, sir?
That is correct.
And so this is, we could have, in fact, coasted along on one that was 10 years old, but we like to be more responsive than that. So if we just put the latest revision date, is that okay with you, Brian?
Yeah, is it okay with that? I think it makes sense.
And then, I mean, on average, I would say every couple of years would be probably way ahead of the game.
Yeah.
I think it makes sense to wait until all of those, or most of those plans have actually been revised, because I think that's part of our issue now, where we're kind of going.
Yeah.
We don't have any updated input.
And the issue with not putting a revisit date is that could we ever do it? I mean, who wants to revisit a plan? So if we don't say we're going to do it in 2 years, you know, what are the chances of us ever doing it?
Is there any language? Sorry, go ahead. I was just wondering, if this is kind of changing the subject, but has anybody had new ideas about the small grant portion? Because that was... And we had a few issues with it when those small grants came before us. And I don't know if anybody had time to think about changes to the small grants that might make them more effective.
That whole section is new.
Yeah.
The small grants. Did you have ideas, John?
Well, it seems like there's two different tracks. If you're encouraging small, less cumbersome applications, then you know you might advertise them differently, or you know I don't know if the committee wants to go down that road, but you know you could be there could be ways to promote that section of it if we determine that's a useful way to go.
And is that something to put into the...
I'm proud of what we crafted, and I can't take credit for most of the work, but I'm proud of what we approved. My concern about it is just the more we put our operating procedures into the plan, the more it...
No, I'm just looking at it.
It's like, this is like our constitution, and the more... And as opposed to our set of laws. And so the more we put into this, the more we can't change this unless we have more public meetings and announcements of public meetings and that sort of thing. So I would like to keep this pretty general and sort of talk about the framework of what we're trying to accomplish in our various areas and have, because we still have a significant subbody of regulatory material to hand out to applicants or anyone interested in our operations. And those we can change almost, you know, as we decide.
Yeah.
Without public.
I didn't intend it to be a discussion specifically for the plan, but just in conjunction with the idea that it is part of the, you know, small grants could be more useful.
Let's mention it.
If we want to put the emphasis there, I mean, again, it could take a different form in terms of the way we advertise it and the way we promote it. I don't know how many people know about small.
Yeah, you know what I'm realizing is we did not have, on this meeting for the agenda, have a debriefing of our last round, of which that came up, you know, mm-hmm. So the first time we addressed that. So I wonder, Sarah, the next...
Did we not
do one? No, their last meeting was right, way late, just appropriating stuff. So we didn't have a meeting since. So I wonder if for an item for the next agenda could be debriefing of the fall round, and in that looking at the first time that we did the small grants and how we could just...
I just wonder what people's feelings were. That might be a good discussion to have at some future date.
Yeah. And it can't be too future, we'll forget all about it. So how about next meeting? Can we put that on the agenda?
Sure.
Sarah?
Next meeting.
Next meeting. That could be another business not foreseen, but...
With regard to the updating of the plan, though, I mean, it seems to... For instance, the historic preservation part of it is deeply tied to what happens in the preservation committee. It's not that the CPA has a totally different agenda from the general historic preservation goals, although I don't know, I don't think that's possible.
It should not be.
It should not be, right. So, in a sense, those things are tied to other plans from other committees. So, in a sense, if they come out with a new plan, it should sort of be, somewhat automatically, incorporated into the CPA plan. And then the other side of it is if there's no big changes in process in the next 10 years, there's no reason to update the plan beyond the specifics of what's been happening, which comes from the committees anyway. So we'll see why there's... Beyond just saying here's what's been happening in the past few years, which comes from the committees, we'll see why you would...
So not putting a time, a year date on this, not to be updated 2 or 3 years.
Well, clearly a considerable burden of time.
Is anyone in favor of putting on a... This will be updated in 2 or 3 years. Nobody? Okay, so leaving it as it is. And perhaps another quick look, since it's all new, if we go back and look at the small grants section and just make sure that that's what we had in mind.
Just for, again, background, for everybody who's new to this committee, basically the whole committee felt it would be great to have some way to fast track applicants that were just asking for small amounts of money. So we did a great deal of discussion about what amounts, what specific, how fast track, and any specific requirements. It went on for considerable time and was fruit of some really good labor on some recent committee members. And we crafted this, and it was, it just came out, what, about a year ago?
Not even that, it's our first round.
Yeah, about 9 months ago. Right. And so this is a fresh and recent thing to try to help make it less formidable to apply for a small amount of money and make it more accessible to people.
And we had two of these small grants come in this cycle. One that we approved as a small grant, and the other we threw back into the hopper of the larger grants, and then ultimately have recommended its approval as well. So, okay. So Jack, are you okay with
this?
So we'll review it, and if we have stuff, try to get to Sarah by, what are you saying, Sarah, Monday?
Monday
the 11th, is that right?
Yes, that is correct.
And anything else on the plan? Yes? No? So hope for folks, I don't know, Sarah, do we put this in the paper? Or how do we advertise it?
I always send out a press release. It makes it sound like a really exciting thing. The paper generally doesn't pick it up. But I do at least send it to the CPA listserv, so about 900 people see it. And it's on the city website.
Okay. So you'll do that again, send the thing out to the Gazette. It would be nice to have folks look at it.
It's also in the legal ed section. No one really seems to do that.
Anything else on the plan? So 2 weeks from now, we'll have our final maybe thing. Other business not foreseen when agenda was published. Anybody else have?
I know I've been a big mouth during this meeting, and I apologize.
Yeah, you have.
Yeah. In addition to that, if I can just say this, you'll find this is a great committee. It's very, very process oriented, and it's a very ethical committee, and it's wonderful to serve on. I think you'll enjoy it. It's very process oriented because we're handing out a lot of money, and it's tax money, and people our people value it, and they expect us to show appropriate stewardship of it. So you will experience meetings that seem to go on forever because we're talking about small points of being completely fair. And it seems tedious at that moment, but it's for a very good cause. And it's so that at the end of the day, we can look back on a variety of projects we've supported over the years and feel like you got the very best review we could possibly give it. And you know, sometimes there's spirited discussion around the room about the benefits of things, and we often don't have enough money to support all of the good projects and proposals that have come in. But it's, like I said, you'll see the process orientation. It just isn't, I think it's inevitable. I've seen Brian is the fifth chair that I've had the pleasure to serve under, and it's just inevitable. It's not him before.
It's never me, Brian.
And the last thing I'll say is that we have some incredibly fun meetings. Whenever there's an application from Little League or an elementary school for a playground, or the playing fields out in Florence, this room gets flooded with the cutest little folks who are pleading it earnestly, sometimes with signs for playground renewals or this or that, and it's the most touching, wonderful thing in the world to be able to support those projects, and we do. So you love those.
Do you have an update for us for money for next round? Is that readily available just so we can?
I will send it. I don't want to disconnect from this site and get back to my.
And you are making recommendations to City Council or passing on our recommendations when?
There's only one actual business meeting this month, so it's the last meeting in January and first meeting in February.
Great. Any additional business? Wow. New folks, don't think this is.
we like Ryan.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
I move.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?